want to inform the segue that the destination is going to be what, ultimately? Or rather, we want to inform the destination view controller that its delegate is going to be self, the main side. So recall the same paradigm in the utility application we played with in class that you've probably begun with for Evil Hangman or about to, whereby when you click that done button, you want the transition to go back and you need to know to whom to return control, in this case the main view controller. So that begs the question, where is this quoted string coming from? Where is this identifier for the segue? So if we go to the storyboard and I click on the segue itself, not much happens over here, but notice that this is apparently of type modal segue from button flip to flip side view controller. That's the English friendly string. I'm going to have to make my UI a bit of a mess and open up over here the right-hand panel. And with that segue selected, if I go up here to the attributes inspector, notice that the programmer who made this template, in this case at Apple, manually typed in an identifier of show alternate. But again, that could have been foo, bar, any string there. And that's to uniquely identify that transition. So in short, if we want to somehow wire together the user interface in this different paradigm, whereby the both sides of the application are in one file, we simply have to define what happens when that transition occurs. So I mention these now because if you want to take things further, say for your own native application, if you go that route for the third, you'll find that this is a very common paradigm now with iOS programming because it really eliminates a lot more of the wiring that you need to do and it centralizes the UI in one place. And as this picture kind of suggests, if you have a particularly complex UI, like a menu and then a submenu and other submenus and other submenus, you can wire them all together within the confines of the same tool. And it's just a simplification. Yeah.
Is there a disadvantage of wiring the information to the second page and then going back to the first page?
Good question. Is there a disadvantage? Not really. The gripe people tend to have with Interface Builder or using nibs or storyboards in this way is that you don't have as much low-level control and you can't necessarily sometimes takes more steps to implement than you want. And once you start having to write code to talk to your nib files and whatnot, at that point a lot of people feel, I'll just do it all from scratch. And so that's why we just saw in the master view, the master detail application, the master was all code, even though the detail used a bit of wiring. And the no nib example last week was just all code. So it's just a trade-off. And a lot of people, seasoned iOS developers, tend to prefer just doing things from scratch. And of course, if you're bored with iOS's built-in UI and aesthetics, you have to do it from scratch if you want to layer things on top. Good question. All right, so let's start something truly from scratch now. And based on time, we can pull a pre-baked cake out of the oven, namely implementing an automated teller machine, so a cash machine, a bank machine, that simulates the idea of depositing money into a bank account and actually doing some math to keep track of a total account balance. So let me go ahead and create a new project. We'll do this as a single view application, just to keep the focus now on the logic and less on details like the transitions between scenes. And let's go ahead and start. I'll call this ATM. I'm not going to use storyboards. I'm going to use the lower level nib approach, especially since we only need one anyway. I'm going to go ahead and click Next, save it on my desktop. And now I get our standard files over here on the top left. We could tell the story as before, but it's probably getting a little redundant now. Main.m somehow invokes the app delegate, somehow invokes the view controller, and the UI for the view controller comes from the nib. So let's go ahead and create a little bit of an interface here for my ATM. So I'm going to go ahead and make my whole background white just because. And then let's see. I want my ATM to look more like maybe a calculator with a total input field up here, maybe a total account balance down here, and then a whole bunch of numbers. So let's start to wire this up. I'm going to go ahead and have a UI label up top here. I'm going to drag it to be as wide as is recommended. Let me go ahead and increase that font size to make it, let's say 36. OK, now we'll go ahead and make it a little bigger. And now let me go ahead and do another label that's down here toward the bottom. This is going to be my, actually, let's just copy and paste this for so we get the same font size more quickly. I'm going to go down here. This will be my balance. All right, and now I need a whole bunch of buttons to represent this thing. So I'm going to go into my rounded rect button here. And let's see, this will be the number, let's see. Let's go ahead and match this lest we get it backwards. Let's go in to save time to the ATM. Xcode project. And dot, 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 so that we don't spend all day dragging and dropping. Voila. Now I have this interface. So what's now on the screen? Well, I right aligned the text. So just by clicking in the attributes inspector, I centered this field here. And I added another UI label just to say balance, just for user interface. So there's one label, two labels, three labels. So these aren't input text fields per se, but they're sort of output displays. So in my code, I can display what the user's typing here. And I can display what the user has in their account down here. All right, so what might I want to do next? Well, the goal is I want the user to be able to type in like 50 deposit in order to deposit $50 in his or her account. And then I want to see 50 down here. And if I then do 10 deposit, I want to see a total account balance of 60 down here. So we somehow need to represent a few things that are going on here. One, all of these buttons need to be somehow connected to my code so that when I push the number 5, and then the number 0, a couple of things happen. One, those numbers get saved in RAM somewhere. Two, they display, like a calculator would, 50 up here. So I somehow need my code to talk to my interface, which is going to require a IB. In this case, if I want my code to talk to the UI, an IB outlet in that direction. By contrast, when I push a button, I want to trigger an IB action to my code. So I have some blue lines going in both directions, or we can do it purely in code as we've seen. And then I have two special buttons, deposit, of course, and then the clear button. So before we get there, I'm going to go ahead and propose, let me roll back in time. So here's where we were a moment ago. And let's assume that we're seeing now the cake being made. And then we'll skip to the ending here. So as we're making this thing, I've realized in the top left that this is an opportunity to have a model, the M in MVC. Because this is like a mechanical machine or a digital machine that somehow has to store account balances. So what might I want to model in this program? Well, maybe the notion of an account. In fact, an account, like a bank account, could be modeled pretty well as an object or an instantiation of some class. And inside of an account is going to be one or more pieces of data. And the only one I'm going to care about for now is the account balance. So in order to do this, I'm going to go up to an option that we probably haven't used, but it's pretty straightforward, File, New, File. So not a new project, just create a new file. And you'll see an interface that looks a little overwhelming at first because there's a lot of options. But really, they're just different templates via which to start a new file. And all I'm going to want is an Objective-C class. So I'm going to go ahead and click Next. And I'm going to call this thing account. It's asking me what should it be a subclass of. NS object is fine. Most everything descends from NS object. So that's fine for my purposes. I'm going to go ahead and click next. Going to go ahead and click create. And voila, at the top left of my file, I now have the ability to represent an account object. So let's see what I've gotten for free. In account.h, I have interface, account descends from NS object. And in account.m, I just have a blank implementation. So now I have an opportunity, again, for the first time to implement some notion of an account balance. And I'm going to propose the following. In my .h file, I'm going to propose a property that's going to have, let's say, a sign. We'll come back to that in a moment. Non-atomic attributes. I'm going to propose that this be an unsigned long, long balance. So a couple of details pop out here. So one, unsigned, just to be clear, means that the value can only be non-negative. So it can include zero. So that's what unsigned would mean. All right, so long, long, what's that? What's the role there? We want it to be 64-bit. So on this platform, doing a long, long gives me a 64-bit number. And that just means it's pretty darn big. I want to avoid what's generally called integer overflow, whereby if we type in too big of a number, I don't want it to roll over with as high probability to some random number. Turns out this is not an adequate defense. We can still break this ATM and deposit an arbitrary amount of money in our account pretty easily. But we'll simulate that in a bit. Non-atomic, this just has to do with multi-threading. I'm writing very simple code here. There's not going to be two threads trying to touch the account at once, though there could be certainly in a world with multiple ATMs on a network. But we'll keep it simple. And assign now is different. Typically, we've seen what attribute in lines like this? Yeah. So we've seen copy. But more commonly thus far in our examples, we've seen strong or weak in this case. So assign literally just does just that. It gives me a setter that literally moves a value from the right-hand side of an expression to the left-hand side. There's no checking for duplicate values. There's no deep copying of objects. And this is perfectly fine for what's generally called a primitive, like a long long. A long long is just 64 bits. To copy 64 bits, you just assign it from the right to the left with an equal sign in between. So there's no need for strong or weak, which have to do with objects and pointers. A copy also has to do with objects and pointers. Assign is just for primitive. So that's all I've specified here. OK, and by default, is this read-write or read-only? It's read-write, which means I get a setter and a getter automatically by having declared this property here. OK, so we're going to keep the account simple. We're not going to bother with account numbers or names or any of that. We're just going to keep it simple with our placeholder there. And now in my implementation of this object, I might want to do one thing. So it turns out an NS object, recall, comes with some default functionality in the form of an init method. And that init method is defined in the NSObject class. And typically, that method does nothing by default. But it's an opportunity for us to do something. What might you want to do in the way of initialization when you instantiate an account object for the first time? Yeah, so why don't we set an initial balance? So the signature for an init method, if you look at the documentations for NS object, or just in general, the convention in iOS is, or in Objective-C, is to have an instance method, hence the hyphen, returns an ID, which is a pointer or nil, and it's called init by convention. So it's kind of like it's the initialization half of a constructor. Alloc would be the other half. Again, a common paradigm is to say now this, if self gets super init. So this is just a common way of saying, one, call the parent class's implementation of init. Make sure that it doesn't return nil, because if it does return nil, I don't want to start doing work unnecessarily, lest I create problems. And now, if all is well, I'm going to do self.balance gets 0. And then I need to return myself. So that's it. If I deleted all of this, we wouldn't be initializing the primitive to a known value. So this way, we have a default value. Or we could be nice, right? If the first time you sign up for a bank account, you get some free gift, maybe you get $100 in your account. And we could do that right here. Yes?
Why do you have to do super alloc and init?
Because that would be bad. Because when init is called, alloc has already been called. So the convention is call alloc, then init. So if init called alloc, that would be trying to instantiate the object twice. Good question. All right, so that's it. This is a super, super simple model, if you will. But it's representative of how we could go about encapsulating information. And maybe in a fancier world, this information would come from a database. And if it did, it could go in this model code. But we're going to use it just as an abstraction for what an actual account balance is. So now, what more do we have to do? Well, let me jump back to the pre-baked version that looks now like this. Notice that at top left, I have the exact same code that I wrote in advance. So I have a property called balance. And I have an implementation of init. So if we go back to the nib, I also did a few things in advance, consistent with what we said was necessary. One, I wired all of the buttons to my code using IB actions. And I wired my code to two different UI labels via IB outlets. So two directions. Now, how can I check what directions they went in? Well, let me go ahead and choose the number 7. And notice that if I hold Control and click on there, there's a whole bunch in this dropdown. But the interesting one, recall from last week, is touch up inside. That's this act. And the result of that is to do what? Files owner digit. What could that mean? Call a method called digit on what object? On the files owner, which in this case is going to be view controller. Exactly. So I'm in the view controller class is nib. And the files owner is going to be the .m file. So let's take a look at the .m file. And indeed, there is, nested among a few other methods, a method called digit. So I've declared this as an instance method. It returns an IB action by convention, which is just synonymous with, remember your lower level C details? It's just void, just returns void, which means it returns nothing. And it takes a pointer called sender. And what is that going to be a pointer to? The button that was pressed. So this is my way of programmatically knowing what button was actually pressed. So here's a bit of a trick that we've leveraged with the UIView class. Notice in this first line of code, I'm doing the following. On the left-hand side, I instantiate what? Good. Pointer to a UI button. And I keep asking this question.